So I have started the recording. And let me also share my screen with you guys. Okay, so I hope you guys can view the screen and read its contents. So last time we were discussing operator overloading, and I think we were discussing the how to overload unary operators, the array subscript operator, and the OStream cout, the less than thing. So let me open it again. I think it was not complex too. Yes, here it is. So we had the last thing we had implemented, it was this operator, OStream. Line number 68 to 71. So for this one, we went in a little hurry. So if you guys have any questions regarding last class, like when you have to overload the unary operator, excuse me, the plus plus thing, whether it's pre-increment or post-increment, or the array subscript operator, or this cout thing. Have you guys got any questions? Now is the time to, stop and ask me if there's something that is confusing you about operator overloading. The last class and the class before the last class. I am not hearing anything. Is everything clear to everybody? Especially the last cout one, we went in a hurry. So I don't know whether you guys totally understood it or not. Come on, that's not good. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so any questions? Have you guys tried this at home, operator overloading? It's part of the assignment. But there are no questions from nobody. Or is it the fasting effect? Okay, so if you guys are not, yes, somebody wanted to say
सर
something.
चैट पे क्वेश्चन लिखे
Chat, I can't see the chat. Okay, I think it's a problem perhaps on my end then. Let me reboot this stuff. Give me a minute, I'll reboot MS Teams and join again. Okay. Now, thank you for pointing it out because MS Teams, it has this curious bug that if you keep it running for too long, it like the chat fails to update. So from time to time, you have to reboot it. So kindly explain the array subscript again. Repeat the array subscript operator. Okay. So let's look at the array subscript operator again. Let me share the screen. Okay, so Ozair was saying that it's easy. Did you solve the problem of your cout operator?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Okay, so let's look at the array subscript operator. So array subscript operator, basically, how is it used? We know that in array, we can have many elements inside an array. So let me declare an array here, and let's call it a 10. And the let's make it 5 bullets. Initialize it. So let's call it 44, 33, 12. So when we use the array subscript operator, basically we use it like this. We can modify any of these values. Let's say at index 2, we want to modify it and we want to make it 1. So the idea is that array itself, it has many elements inside it. Okay, here we have 5 elements. So the array subscript operator is used to choose basically one of those elements inside the array. So that's the basic purpose, I mean built-in purpose for which it is used in C++. So when you have many elements and subscript operator basically gives you the opportunity to select one of those operators. Okay. So this array subscript, you can use it to the left of the assignment operator or to the right of assignment operator. Okay, so this one basically we have used to the right of the assignment operator in order to assign a value to the element at index 2. Similarly, we can also use it on the left of Sorry, right of the assignment operator and so when we are basically using it on the left side of the assignment operator, we are writing into it. And similarly, when we are using it on the right side of the assignment operator, we are basically using the array of subscript operator to choose the element inside the array whose value we want to read and then assign it to int bb. So it is both used to read and write values to a particular element inside an array. So the syntax is basically you take the array name and after the array name you basically put the square brackets and inside the square brackets you give the index which is basically used to identify the element whose value you want to read or write. Okay, in both cases, in reading and writing, we use the same syntax. So this is the use of the array subscript operator to choose one element inside the array and read or write its value. So array subscript operator is already loaded, overloaded for integers. I'm sorry, arrays. Built-in arrays of integers, arrays of characters, float, etc., and other arrays. Even for user-defined arrays of user-defined types, it's already overloaded. It works. But what if we want to use it with non-array types? Non-array. Let's say we have this myComplex type, and we have declared this object. C5 of type myComplex. This object is not an array. It's one object only. So with one object, what if, but this one object internally, it contains more than one elements. It contains the real part, the imaginary part. Okay, so in our case, my complex, it contains only two elements, but in the real world scenario, an object can contain lots and lots of elements inside itself. So what if we want to use this array subscript operator, not with arrays, but with single objects? So just like we are using it here. So we are using this C5 0. We are basically reading the value of 0th element inside C5. And here on line number 86, we are using it to the left of the assignment operator to write the value of element number 0 inside the object C5. Okay, so if we want to use it with non-array types, with objects, single objects, for example, in that case, it's not basically defined to work with single objects. To make it work with single objects, we have to redefine it, or we have to overload it for our new user-defined type. So how do we overload it? Here, basically, just like any other operator, we can overload this operator also. And this operator, basically, here is the syntax. Here is the syntax of operator overloading for this array subscript operator. One particularity of this array subscript operator is that it cannot be a non-member function. For other operators, many operators, we have the option whether we want to make those operators when we are overloading them. We can either make them member functions or non-member functions. But this we discovered in our last class, that for array subscript operator, the standard says that this operator has to be a member function of the class for which we are overloading it. So this, we are defining it inside the MyComplex class as a member function. Otherwise, its syntax is the same operator, the keyword operator, and then the square brackets telling you basically which operator we are overloading. In this case, it's the array subscript operator. So we have this two square brackets. And this basically function will take one argument. Okay, so that argument will be the value that will be given inside the array subscript operator. Okay, inside the, when you are, we will use this array subscript operator with our type, inside the square brackets, we will give it some value. That value will be used to identify the element that you want to read or write. So that value need not necessarily be an int. It can be a character, it can be a string, or whatever. But here, in our example, we chose it to be an integer. Okay, so we said that we will identify the element inside the object with an integer. So we'll be using only two values of integer. 0 would mean the real part, and 1 will mean the imaginary part. So here, the array subscript operator, when you will use it inside the brackets, it will receive an integer value in our code. Okay. We could have easily made it a character or whatever. So here, we are doing an integer. So the integer that we will give inside the array subscript operator, when we'll use it inside our code, it will be received here inside this function as an argument. So what we have to do is, once we have received the argument, we check its value, and basically if the value is valid, we do what we, I mean, plan to do, what we had said that we'll do with this array operator. So here, basically, we check if the index value given is 0, then the user is trying to access the real part of this object, and if the value is 1, then the basically user is trying to access the imaginary part of this object. So there it is. Basically, once we have defined this object, sorry, this operator, overloaded this operator for our type, then we can use this overloaded operator, I mean the array subscript operator, with objects of our type MyComplex, just like we had seen here. If you go at the bottom, now we can use basically this C5 and the array subscript operator 0 or 1 with this object to basically access the 0th element, which is the real part of the this object C5, we can read or write it. Similarly with C5.1, we can access the imaginary part. One thing to note here is the return type of this operator. So the return type is an integer reference. It's not just an integer. Here we are using the real and imaginary part, which are both integers, but the return type we have declared it as an integer reference, okay? Not just a simple integer, because when we return a simple integer, it is returned by copy. But here we do not want to return a copy. We are returning a reference. So can somebody tell us why we are basically returning a reference? What will go wrong if we return a copy? Yeah, so that's the question. What is the significance of returning a reference? Rest of the codes on GitHub. All codes are on GitHub. I mean, every code that we have discussed in the class is on GitHub, I think. So for those who think they have understood, what's the significance of returning a reference? What will not work if we do not return a reference? If I remove this reference symbol, ampersand symbol from this return type, what can go wrong? Hello. Those who think they have understood this concept. Yes, sir.
Sir, because here we are returning the new value, means if we return only integer, it will be least efficient by returning the integer reference. We will get the new value and return the new one.
What do you mean by the new value?
Sir, after performing all the operations inside the operator definition, and the value means like the result when we return the result. So there will be a new value as us. So it will return the new value, not the copy value.
Here, if we see this operator, overloaded function from line number 24 till line number 32, we are not modifying any value. Okay, so the question of new and old does not apply here, since this function is not modifying any value. So it is basically the same value that we will return. Whether we do it by integer or integer. So yes, so the answer is what Hamza has written here. Very good. Again, C5.0 won't work, copy of real. So the thing is, we will come to this second question. It's related to this same thing, but let's first answer this question, that why do we need to return the reference and not a simple copy. So the thing is this, if I remove this reference, what it will do is it will basically, we have the object C5, and on object C5 we are applying this subscript operator. So what we this subscript operator function, overload function, will do is that it will take, let's say we have written C5.0. So what it will do is it will basically take this real part of C5, okay, since it's being called by the C5 object, so it can access the real, the variable, private variable real of C5. It will take its the real part of C5. It will make a copy of it, and here this int is telling it that return that copy. So returning that copy means that it will leave the original variable at its place and return a copy of its value. So if we return a copy of its value, then the thing is here, as these guys said, here we are basically using C50 both to read and to write the real part of C5. So if you return a copy, then for reading it's good, because here cout will receive a copy of the value of the real part of C5 and it will display that copy. So for reading it's good. And similarly, one imaginary part also, it will receive a copy. So for reading, a copy is good. The problem arises when we want to use it for writing. Okay, so here this line number 86, it means that we want to write the value 77 in the real part of C5. So if we use an integer without an ampersand, so this part of assignment operator, the left part, it will call that function and it will basically receive this on the left side of the assignment operator. We will receive a copy of the real part of C5, not the original variable, which is the real part of C5. We will not receive it. We will receive a copy of the real part of C5. So what this assignment operator will try to do, it will try to write this 77 value into that copy, which was not the intention here. Line number 86, basically the intention is to write the value 77 into the real part of the object C5, not into copy of the real part of the object C5. So that's why if you want to use it to write, well, for reading it's okay, but if you want to use it to write the real part of C5, in that case we cannot return a simple integer, because that would be a copy, but rather we have to return a integer reference. Okay, so reference, as you guys know, reference is not a copy. Reference is just another name for this same variable. Okay, that will be returned. It will return a reference to the real part of C5. Similarly, line number 31, it will return a reference to the imaginary part of C5. So with the reference now, we can see here that this C50, now it will not return a copy, but rather it will return a reference to the real part of C5. Okay, so since assignment operator now has access to the real part of C5, it can write this value 77 to the real part of C5 through that reference. Okay, so that's the reason that we want to return a reference from this array subscript operator and not a simple copy. Is it clear? How to overload the array subscript operator and why do we want to return a reference and not a copy of the variable from this array subscript operator? Yes. Before we come to this comment, those who asked this question, is it clear, the working of array subscript operator? It would be nice if you guys can make a simple yes, no. That's not cool. So those who ask this question, okay, who was it? Zain Toki. And Omer. Is the array subscript operator clear? Zain Toki, Omer, if you guys ask some question, then please have the courtesy to respond to whether it's understood or not. Okay, thank you. Hopefully it will be the same for Zain also. So now I'll come to these questions that you guys have asked. Okay, so I'll start from the simplest question. Mudfari, you asked whether if we wanted only to read the value, then we will not need to return a reference, just returning a copy would suffice. So that's correct. If we did not want to write the value and only read the value of, let's say, imaginary or real part, in that case, yes, we do not have to return a reference. Returning a simple copy containing that value is good enough. The other thing that Mohammed Fahri pointed out is this concept of L value and R value. So what do you guys understand by this concept of L value and R value? So there are two concepts that were introduced by C language, I mean, used by C language, which initially it was simple, but now C++ has taken the complexity to a whole new level, but we'll just have a simple, introduction to these concepts. So there's a thing called L value and there's a thing called R value. Has anybody heard of it? Number five, what do you understand by L value and R value? Very good. So that's a very simple and correct definition of the way to remember it. That L value, basically, let me write a few things here in the code. So if I say int my m1 is equal to 33, okay. And let's say int m2 is equal to m1. And int m1 is equal to 2. Okay. Okay. So the initial concept, their nomenclature at least derives from which side of assignment operator these values find themselves. So L value basically is equal to left side of assignment operator, and R value is equal to right side of assignment operator. Okay, so this was the concept initially, that assignment operator has two sides, the left side and the right side. So what the working is, that whatever is to the right of the assignment operator, it can be a very long complex expression containing multiple operators, function calls, etc., whatever. So to the right side of the assignment operator, whatever you have, the operator will first evaluate that expression. Okay, so it will execute all those function calls, all those operators, etc., and perform those operations, and ultimately it will calculate one single value. So that value, then what the assignment operator will do, it will assign this value which has been calculated to the right side of the assignment operator to the memory location which has been given on the left side of the assignment operator. Okay, so on the left side we have to have some memory location, because the job of the assignment operator is to store the value on the right side in that memory location. Okay? So if there is no memory location, then the assignment operator won't know where to store that value. So on the left side we have to have a memory location. So in variables, basically we give the memory locations sometimes by giving the name of the variable. Okay, so int m1 is a new variable, it will have some memory location associated with it. So when we give m1 to the left side of the assignment operator, then this is an L value. Okay, so m1 has a memory location associated with it in which this value 33 will be stored. So as Muhammad Faris said, L value means something that has a memory location associated with it. Okay, so that can be a name of the variable, that can be a dereferenced address, let's say star A, and we have this address, let's say 0x5555 is equal to 3. Again, you see on the left hand side we have this address which is assuming address of some memory location, and then we dereference this address. So here on the left hand side we get a memory location. Since it's a memory location, then we can store this value 3 in that memory location. Okay, so this dereference address, this is also an L value because it has a memory location associated with it in which we can store values. So this is basically the basic definition of an L value. And now on the right hand side, on the right hand side we have this again M1 variable name which has a memory location associated with it, but since it is basically used on the right hand side, so we are not using here, when we use it on the right hand side, we do not use we do not mean the memory location associated with it. We want the value which is stored in this memory location. Okay, so what happens is this expression, which is a single variable, it will be evaluated and a final value will be produced. So here basically this evaluation of a single variable gives us the value of that variable stored in that memory location. Okay, so M1 value, which is 33, will be used to be stored in this M2, which is another variable, and L value, which has a memory location associated with it. Okay, so values on the right hand side, they become R values, and values on the left hand side, they should be L values because the assignment operator needs some memory location to store the result that it has calculated on the right hand side. For example, this expression 33 is equal to M1. Okay. Now this is wrong. The compiler will tell you that L value required on the left hand side. Let's see the error message. Okay, so you see, you read this error message, it means an L value is required as a left operand of assignment. Okay, because 33 is just a literal, it has a value, but it has no memory location associated with it. It's not the address of a memory location, it's not the name of a variable. So assignment operator does not know how to store this value of M1 in 33. Okay, so this is the concept of L value and R value. So this is good. So here, as Muhammad Faris said earlier, that here to store this value 77 into something, we need an L value. So a memory location where it can store this value 77. So the real part of the C5 object, it has a node location. When we return the reference to the real part of the C5, the reference, as you know, is just another name for that real part of C5. So here we receive an L value, which is basically the node location of the real part of C5. Okay, so that's why we are able to store the 7782, that real part of C5. Is it clear the concept of L value and R value? Okay, so no response. I am assuming that it's good. Okay, now let's discuss a few other things that we couldn't in the last class. So we basically discussed why do we need to return a reference for this array subscript operator. Yeah. But last time we were even using reference when we were basically passing arguments to these functions. You see here my complex arg is not passed by value, but rather is passed by reference. So again, who can tell me why or when do we need to pass a reference in the argument of a function? Good. If we want to change that argument being passed, so we do not want it to be passed as a copy, but rather we want it to be passed as the original argument's reference. Okay, so that when inside the inside this, what do you call it, this function, inside this function, so that we can change the value of the original variable that is being passed to this argument. Very good. So this is one of the most common cases when you want to pass an argument as a reference. But let us take the example of this O stream, put line number. Here we are taking this O stream object LHS, the first argument. We are taking it as a reference, and even though we are not changing this object inside this function, but we are still taking it as a reference. Why do you guys think here is a, by the way, here if we make it a non-reference like this, it will still work, I think. Okay, we'll have to change this here also. We have to change the non-reference, but I am passing it as a reference even though I'm not changing it here inside the function. I'm not changing this reference LHS, but still I'm passing it as a reference. Can you guys take a guess in which situation we pass arguments as references even though we do not intend to change its value? Okay, so you guys know that if I remove this reference from the argument type, it will be passed by copy, which means a local copy. So it displays a bit value. That's one reason, but there's another reason also, that when we basically remove this reference, then a local copy of OStream object will be made, and we'll use that local copy to display these values on the screen. Now, when making copies, now you guys know that the objects which are not built-in types, they can have lots of things inside them. Okay, so when you make a copy, then copy constructors are called, which make copies of these objects. The thing is, these objects, these user-defined objects, they can be very, very big. Here, for the moment, we are only using objects which have only a few members of very small size. So the size of our objects is not very big. But it can be very, very big, huge objects containing lots of members of very big size. For example, you can have a class image, which can have, let's say, images inside it, and those images can be huge, like megabytes, tens of megabytes of images. So when we make copies of those objects, then performance-wise, it's very costly. Every time we call a function, we have to make a copy of that image object. Okay, so copying megabytes of data or tens of megabytes of data, it can be very costly, especially if you call those functions very frequently. So in those cases where these object sizes are very big and we do not want to make frequent copies, especially when these copies are only temporary, and after this function we will not need those copies. Okay, so that will be a waste of time, processor time, and also a waste of processor memory, because those we have to copy memory from the original object to the copy, etc. So to avoid those extra copies, and because they will also slow down our program, we basically, instead of passing copies of objects, we try to pass references to those objects, so that we do not have to copy those objects every time. Okay, is it clear? Sometimes those objects are very big and we do not want to make copies of those objects every time we call a function. So instead of passing copies, we pass references to those objects. To others also, I hope it's clear. So in that case, the problem is that sometimes let me take another example where we have basically passed some copy. Let's modify this function. The add function, it will take two arguments of type myComplex. It will add it and return the result. Now let's assume that this myComplex object, it's a very big object. Assume that its size is like 100 MB. And we do not want to basically pass copies of or copy these objects all the time, every time we call this operator plus or add complex. I think it's add complex. Yeah, let's keep this add complex function, okay? Not the operator, but the add complex. It will suffice our needs. So instead of passing these references, I basically pass this as a reference. Okay. So this basically does not change anything. I have to make the change here also. Okay, so once we have done this, then we can call add complex here. C6 equal to add complex C1, C2, and then C6. So add complex. So this will basically take, and now instead of making copies of C1 and C2 inside the add complex, it will basically take references to this C1, C2, use those objects, references, through the references, and then return us the sum of these two objects, C6. Okay? So assuming this size of my complex was 100 megabytes, so we saved ourselves these two copies of 100 megabyte objects. But one thing is here, since now we are taking these objects as references, a problem may arise that we might accidentally change the values of these two objects. Right? Since we are references, so we are basically accessing the original object. So we might basically accidentally, assuming that we are doing it accidentally. Here is a 1-line code, so it's difficult to make a mistake. But if inside this function the code was like 200 lines, then it is very easy to change the original object by accident. So by making these, if they were copies, even if we change those copies accidentally inside the function, that would have not affected the original object. Okay, so copies like are kind of a barrier between the original object and our local function objects. So damaging the local object does not damage the original object. But in our quest for efficiency or performance, instead of passing copies, we are now passing references. So although this function is not meant to basically change the original arguments being passed to it, but since these arguments are references, so we are exposing ourselves to the risk that we might accidentally change or corrupt this original variable. So how can we prevent ourselves from this accidental mishap while using this pass by reference?
By making the original argument constant.
Zabardast. So what we can do is we can make the original object constant. Let's go here. I think const, you can put it before or after this. So it's a reference to a const object of type my complex. Okay. So here, if we are doing it now by accident in our very long code, we have made a mistake and corrupted the original object, then in this case, the compiler basically, it will give us an error that here. Since the object was not meant to be modified, so we have declared it const. So here, when we accidentally corrupt it, we did not realize our mistake, but the compiler realized and caught our mistake. It said that you are, what the description, int real. No. So error increment of member of a read-only object. Okay. So const meant that that was not supposed to be modified. It was only supposed to be read the value. So we can make it const, and this will basically guard us or save us from our own accidental mistakes. Okay. So it's a good practice that whenever you are passing a reference of something that you do not intend to modify, if you intend to modify this original value, in that case it's good. But if you're passing a reference that you do not intend to modify inside the function, then it's considered good practice, almost compulsory, in fact, to declare it as const, okay, to prevent us from accidentally corrupting this object. Okay, so the more you basically protect yourself from accidental errors, the happier you will be in life, especially with C++. Now the thing with this const object is that when we try to, let's say, inside this function, let me remove this thing, remove this error, accidental error, and before, let's say we want to call a function on A. It should be possible to call a function on A. because show is a number function of a, so we want to call a dot show. Now the thing is, with const object, this will pose a problem, because let me show you the error. When I compile it, we have removed original error. We are just calling a function show inside add complex. Okay. My complex is private within this context. This is something else. So I think add complex should be made a member friend function. Add complex is a friend function. Okay, sorry. We did not change the prototype. We did not change. Okay. Now it should be good. Now it's good. And the error that is giving is that we are passing it a const object. And this show function, it is not happy because we are calling this call to void show. It is not happy with this call to this function. So do you guys know why? Because since we are calling this function on a const object, it's a member function, and member function have access to the private data of every object. So inside this member function, how do we know that this object is not being modified inside this function? Okay, so compiler basically is telling you that you are calling a function on this constant object, and that function may modify the object, const object. Okay, so again, accidentally, you can, by calling such a function, you can corrupt this object. So the compiler basically gives you an error, and how to solve this error? The thing is that you have to make this function show. There's a thing called a const function. Okay, so we have to make this show a const function. And how do we make a function const? Basically, after this parenthesis of arguments, we put a const. Okay. So const function, basically, inside, you're telling the compiler that inside this function, I will never modify any part of this object. Okay. So only const functions can be called on a const object. Now that we have made this show const, so calling this const function on this const object, the add complex here, this should now be okay. So let's see. It compiled. So const function, basically you can call const functions on const objects, and const functions are basically those functions where you have told the compiler that you will never modify this object inside this function. Okay. For example, if by after declaring this function const, if I had made it here real is equal to 22, then you will see that the compiler will detect it, and it will tell me that you are modifying your, you see, assignment of real in a read-only object. Okay, so inside this const function, we are modifying this object. So const function, you have guaranteed your compiler that you will never modify this object inside this function. So that's why modifying a variable of that object inside this const function gives you gives us an error. So there you go. And now that you know that you can make const functions, any function that is not modifying the object, you can declare it const. And const functions can be called on const objects. Okay, so now we can call this const function inside this object, and it will be good. Okay, so voila. So this is the thing, that any reference that you do not intend to modify inside a function declared const, and only const functions can be called on const objects. Okay, so this way we are guaranteed that this const object will never be corrupted, even accidentally. Whenever there is a corruption, the compiler will detect it and it will warn us. So Tala, what I said was that inside this, whenever you want to pass a reference to a function, a reference that you do not intend to modify inside a function, you should declare it a const reference, okay? So that you do not intend internally accidentally modify that reference, that object inside the function. So this thing I hope is clear. Now the problem arises that on const objects, you cannot call normal functions, normal member functions inside on a const object. Why? Because any function internally has access to the object's private member variables, which we call the object state. So that function can modify the object state or its private data. Okay. So if we call, if we are able to call a normal function on a const object, then again we are risking that accidentally we might call a function which may accidentally modify or corrupt the const object. That's why the C++ standard, it makes a difference between distinction between normal function and const function. So const functions are those that do not modify the object's variables or object state. Therefore, the standard only allows const functions to be called on const objects. This way, the constness of the object is preserved. Okay, good. So if the object is declared as const and the function is also declared const, then there is no need to put const and const inside the function. Yes. Inside the function argument. If the argument is const, no, the thing is const objects, basically the thing is you cannot pass a const object to a non-const argument. The type mismatch will occur and the compiler will give you an error, because the object's type is const myComplex and the argument type is myComplex. Okay? So we cannot convert a non-const type, sorry, we cannot convert a const type to a non-const type. The reverse is good. You can always convert a const non-const type into a const type, but you cannot convert a const type into a non-const type. So let me give you an example. Here we go. Let me try this. I think it should work. Okay, let's verify whether it works with const or not. Okay. It works. So now let's make these objects non-const. So these references are non-const, but the objects that we'll be passing to these references here, C7, C8, they are both const objects. So here now the compiler will shout that binding reference of type myComplex non-const to a const myComplex. Okay, so it discards qualifier. The thing is, the compiler looks at these things by looking at the types of these objects. So the thing is, these C7, C8, they are const objects. Okay, so they should not be modified. But once inside this function, once we are inside this function, C7, C8 are not here, but we have access to these C7 and C8 through their references. Okay. So these references are non-const. And when their type is non-const, then it means that we should be able to modify them here. So I can do a.real++ because this reference is non-const. So inside this function, the compiler will look at the type of A, not the original type of C7. The type of A is a normal reference which is modifiable. So here, when we are basically assigning this C7 object to that reference A, the compiler detects it and tells you that if you basically assign this non-const reference to a const object, then you are making an error because inside the function you might accidentally modify this object using that non-const reference. Okay. So here it will give you an error. You can convert const objects to non-const types, but you have to do it explicitly by casting it in C++. Okay. Does this answer your question? Yeah. A is not non-const, but C7, which is being assigned to A, is const. So you cannot bind a non-const reference to a const object, because that way you will be able to modify that object using A. Is it good? The object is declared const, so add complex one has to be declared const. No, you are saying that you want to declare, make the function const add complex. Let me try this thing. I have never tried this thing myself. Okay, so let's do it like this now. Okay. Field add complex has incomplete type my complex. More complex add complex. Okay, so I don't know whether we can make a non-member function const or not. What is the modification in this code? Let me just move this comp from here. I put the const in the wrong place. Sorry. My bad. non-number functions cannot have this CV const volatile qualifier. So apparently you can't make non-number functions as const. So this, I'm afraid, won't work. Const functions, const objects, const functions, it's called. No, a non-member function can't be const, I think. Let me Google this. No, okay. No, const, this constness concept, it's only for member functions. Not for the function itself, can only a member function can be declared const. Non-member functions have no concept of const. Const as a function. You can have const arguments, but the function itself can't be const. And to think of it, it makes sense because in const, by declaring a function const, you are telling the compiler that you are not going to modify the object. Okay, so non-number functions do not have this concept of object associated with them. Okay, let's make it a member. But then we'll have to remove this object one argument because we have to call this function on an object then. And since it's a const function, then that object has to be const also, I think. So let me comment this thing. Now here it should be like this. Okay. So C7 is a const object, so we are calling a const function on a const object at complex. Yeah, C8 is still non-complex. The argument inside this add complex function. So C8 here, it is a object of type const, and it is being used to bind to this non-const object. The original problem that we had, that we were binding, passing const objects to non-const references. Oh no, mid-syllabus, we'll discuss it next week. tomorrow also we have a class at 3:30 as conveyed by your class representative. We have to make it constantly. Yes, if you want to make it pass it a const object, then it's good to make it a const reference. Only const references can be bound to const objects. Okay. So we have a class tomorrow. We'll continue it over there. For the moment, let's. And for the mid syllabus, you should at least, you know, prepare. Let's discuss in tomorrow's class. Any questions regarding what we've discussed today? Whenever we declare an object const, then when we pass those objects to member const functions, we always need to make argument count as well. No, don't think in terms of const functions. Just think about the objects being passed and the argument to which they will be bound. If you are passing a const object, then that argument should also be declared of type const, the reference. Don't think about the const functions when passing arguments. When passing arguments, just think about the argument that you are giving when calling the function and the argument that the function is expecting. So if you intend to pass const objects, then the receiving reference should also be of type const. No, the argument does not have to be passed. You're talking about the function prototype or the argument that will be passed to the function when calling that function. Yeah, in the function prototype, if you do not intend to modify or you want to avoid modifying the values being passed, you have to declare them const. And const, you can only declare const, you can't declare int const. You have to declare it const reference. We can continue this discussion in the next class, tomorrow's class, because it's 3:30, I think. It's 3:30, yeah, Tuzer?
Yes, sir, 3:30.
Okay, so it's 3:30 p.m. tomorrow. We can continue our discussion from here tomorrow. And what's your name? I forgot your name. Hamza Siddiqui, please raise that question tomorrow, because that's a natural continuation of this topic of constant and etc. So if you guys don't have any other questions right now, I'll stop this meeting.